and I am speechless, but at £42.
Welcome to the winter series. You currently join me on a very blustery day whilst fishing the awesome Elphicks complex. Now I'm currently on Pullens Lake, and joining me on this session is Perry Alabaster from last year. So you might have seen last year's winter series where we're over on the North Lake. We're on a different lake this time, i.e. Pullens. So after our success on the North Lake, me and Perry come back for a social on Pullens, and he had a right result out of here, which we'll talk about with Perry in a little while. So at the minute, we're currently set up, like I say, right on the teeth of this wind. I'm to the left-hand side of Perry. Perry's to my right, obviously, but we're both fishing a similar area to where he had an absolute giant last year. So yeah, really looks good for a bit of carp fishing, and hopefully there's a few bites for the pair of us. And also joining us on the opposite side of the lake is Iain Macmillan. So he's tagged along, a few extra rods, you know, can't hurt matters. So we've got the whole lake booked out so we can go wherever we want. If we start seeing fish up the other end of the lake, then obviously we can move up there. But I'm really looking forward to this trip, seeing the sort of monsters that swim around in these lakes up here. I'm mega, mega excited for this trip. Oh, geezer.
Hello, mate, you right?
Yeah.
Good, cheers.
Oh, God, mate, this feels mega.
It's looking good, yeah.
It does feel real. Good, yeah. Really so good. You've fished this place quite a few times, haven't you, Pullens?
I have, yeah, winter, yeah.
Yeah, so what sort of in here then, for people that haven't been here? Loads of monsters.
You know, I don't even think they know, there's so many.
Really?
There's at least, I think I've had four or five different 40s, but there's probably a lot more than that. It could
really?
Be up to 10 40s or something, maybe. Plenty of 30s. I don't know the exact stock, mate.
No.
Maybe 100 or so fish, something like that, perhaps.
Yeah.
I'm just guessing, I don't know.
So you're
not much under £25, I know that.
No, yeah, well, you said earlier on, you're very unlucky if you catch one under £25.
Yeah, the stamper fish is incredible.
Yeah, unbelievable. Now, you know this area quite well, don't you? As you come in, we're actually set up first two swims on the road bank.
Yeah, I think it's the gate swim, this one.
Gate swim,
yeah.
Right, is it?
Yeah.
And yeah, you've fished these before, so.
I have done, yeah.
What's the sort of spots for people that might be coming here?
There's a few in here I've had fish from. The places I've got now, I've got one down tight in this little margin here on the right.
Yep.
I've had fish from there before. It's literally a little flick. It's less than a rod length out, to be honest. Over there on the far margin, there's a shelf, comes gravelly shelf,
yep.
just off of that. That goes right up to the reeds. In front of the reeds can be good.
Yeah.
So anywhere along there, I think they come around that reed line and along into this bay.
Yeah.
I've had them deep into the bay, especially as you get more into the summer, you see them showing right into the bay there.
Yeah.
Off the corner of them reeds, I've had them. Also in open water, off the corner of the island is good. I've seen them showing off open water and cast singles to the showing fish out in the open water.
Yeah.
Off the island. Lots of different spots, really.
It's
one of them swims you could have 10 rods.
Yeah, very nice.
Yeah.
Well, we'll talk about bait and obviously rigs and all that as the session goes on. So we'll talk a little bit about that monster from this year. I actually thought it was last year, but it was this year.
This winter, wasn't it?
Yeah. So we went on the North Lake, didn't we? had a couple out of there, yeah. And then how long was it after that? Only a few weeks after?
Yeah, we had to go on West End, didn't we?
Yes, and,
it was fishing hard. I don't think it had done a bite for 2 months or 3 months nearly.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not easy, West End. It can shut up shop in winter.
Yeah, yeah.
And I remember we'd done one night over there, didn't we?
Yeah.
And we just weren't feeling it, was we? We said, this was free, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. You actually said to me, there's two swims on Pullens.
We sort of pretty much shared an area out there, didn't
we? Yeah, and within an hour.
Went, didn't it? And it was, I think it was, I can't remember,
49, 12
or something.
I think it was close to 50,
wasn't it?
Yeah.
So I weighed it on my scales and I thought, well, just in case mine are wrong, we weighed it on yours.
Yeah, we did, yeah.
And it was exactly the same.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
49 and quite a few ounces, weren't it? But
unbelievable.
Yeah, it was good, wasn't it?
Yeah. So absolutely mega.
It was good.
Yeah. Okay, mate, cool. Well, Iain on the other side has had one.
He's got off to a flyer, hasn't he?
He has got off to a flyer. Yeah. So we're going to pop round there and go and have a look at the one that he's just had.
Yeah, cool.
Winter Elphicks carp. First time I've ever been here, and it took me a mammoth 4.5 hour drive to get here. So I came the night before just so I wouldn't have to leave at 3 o'clock in the morning to get here for the 7 o'clock opening. And this is the result. And I did speak to the owners in the lodge, and they said, don't put a lot of bait out. So it was just a case of half a handful of little 8mm switch, the stuff I've had glugged in yeast extract for quite a long time now, so I didn't want to overfeed. I know the venue does get ruled a bit by maggots, but it's not really my thing, so I wanted to do it my own way. Rig, just a little, well, quite a long German rig, which has been my go-to rig probably for 2018. A large milky malt wafter over the top, and a little bag of crayfish mini mix pellets. And it's as simple as that. And it absolutely roared off with this amazing, scaly looking Elphicks carp at 36.5 pounds. But what a way to open this winter series. I am absolutely buzzing. My hands are Baltic, freezing, but I am actually over the moon to catch this. But what a fish and what a start. Very, very happy indeed. Look at that. This place is unbelievable. And I'm sitting there wailing in my glory of a 36.5 pounder, and a really big fish stuck its nut up right over me, right on rod. And I'm fixated on that spot like that, and then the middle one's gone beep. I thought, oh, that'll be about then. And this is the result. 27.5, and he's got loads of little pin scales down his flank. Just a biblical fish. And for a winter result, you know, I can't even begin to describe how I'm feeling, to be honest. And I've still got a night or two left, so Lord knows what is going to happen. And it was exactly the same tactics as before. I've not put hardly any bait out, like I say, a little handful of the 8mm switch. And again, this was on the German. All three are on Germans, on white, large barrel, milky malt wafters, and little crayfish bags, just mainly to bit of attraction, stopping them tangling. And to be honest, I ain't gonna change it. Two bites in the morning, it's happy days at Elphicks. Okay, so we've had the flurry of a couple of bites down here on Pullens Lake at Elphicks, so now we've got a bit of downtime. I thought I would talk you through the rig. Now, first of all, I am not a technical angler. I've never ever based my angling in all the years I've been doing it on being technical. But for a lot of years, I was predominantly a pop-up angler. So whether that was a stiff hinge rig, a multi-rig, a chod rig, the QC rig in the last few years. And whilst I was super, super confident in pop-ups, I think there is times where a pop-up, even a small pop-up off the deck, probably an inch, I didn't get bites and I thought I should. Now, for those hard spots or those clear lakes like Pullens where we're fishing here at Elphicks, it's all clay, predominantly clay. There's lots of spots of gravel which I'm landing on and you're getting a great drop. So in spots like that, I think even a pop-up rig at times is going to be treated with such suspicion because it's off the bottom that it might cost you bites. So with the popularity of the IQD rig or wafter rigs, as they're probably now known a few years ago, I thought I was missing a trick. So I settled on the German rig, which is what this is. Now, some of you may or may have not used it. The first and probably the most important reason that I use it is because it's simple to tie. I've got loads and loads tied up at any one go. So I get a bite, I unclip it off the quick link, put a new one on, and I can get the rod back out on the spot and leave the fish in the net to get fishing again. So I always tie it with a sort of soft to sort of semi-stiff coated hooklink. Always use a coated hooklink. And I never ever break the coating at all. And it's just a simple knotless knot to a size 4 curve hook. Now, it is quite cumbersome. When I look at it like this and you sort of hold it up like that and you look and you think that is quite cumbersome. But I think that's the reason why it nails them. Because I think, yes, certain fish might suss it, but my catch rate over the last couple of years since using it has told me that they find it really, really difficult to deal with. And maybe that is because it's cumbersome. If you look at the stiff hinge rig, that everybody used to label it as a big fish rig. Well, I don't think there is such a rig as a big fish rig. I think at times any rig will catch fish. I think there's certain fish that the way the mouths are designed or the way that they over slung lips, I think certain rigs like that lend themselves to rigs, the cumbersome rigs like the stiff hinge rig or like the German. So you don't even break any of the coating. You just tie a knotless knot straight to the size 4. I tend to use like a bait screw. Some people would use a hook link, a hook swivel and floss it on. I use the bait screws because they're easy. They're simple to use and it's quick. Little hook bead stop and you're away. And you can see there, there's a blob of putty. Now you can use a sinker or some of these tungsten devices that are on the market, but I just tend to use good old fashioned putty. And the position of that is quite important, which is probably around a centimeter from the eye of the hook. And I think what that does, it keeps everything pinned down. It also keeps the hook flat, as you can see. So obviously your wafter hook bait is just gonna be sitting proud like so. But the putty being so close to the eye of the hook keeps the hook flat on the lake bed. And obviously a lot of the coated braids these days, they're tungsten impregnated, they're heavy. You know, I don't even tend to bother putting putty further up the hook link. You know, so it's very, very simple to use, but very, very effective. And, you know, I probably use this more than the QC rig now. And all I do to add a bit of extra attraction and to stop it tangling, I'm really, really paranoid about a rig tangling. I don't want to reel it in after 12 hours or 2 hours or 48 hours if I'm leaving them out for a long time and it's tangled. So I tend to use a little bag of the crayfish mini mix, which I can't begin to tell you how many carp I've caught in 2018 into 19 on those little bags. So it gives me a bit more attraction, it stops him from tangling, and it's all about confidence with rigs. And you know, I don't think there's a wonder rig. I think there's a lot of rigs on the market that are very, very, very good and very effective, but you've got to pick the one that is going to suit you, whether your ability to tie them isn't as good as somebody else's. This might be the rig for you because it is super, super simple, effective, and very easy to tie, but very, very deadly.
Well, good morning, and what's been quite a frustrating night's fishing. I had liners all night last night on the left hand rod. Honestly thought it was going to go, but nothing come of it. But around about midnight last night, middle rod pulled up tight, leant into it, and as the rod took full test curve, the hook fell out. So yeah, absolutely gutted. I suppose you could blame the barbless hooks maybe, although I like to think that a barbless hook sort of goes in the mouth obviously a lot more easier than a barbed hook, because you haven't got that barb there sort of stopping it from sending that hook home, I guess. But one of them things, unfortunately. It's been very quiet for Perry as well next door, so both had a rebait this morning, and yeah, I'm sort of wondering whether the fish are here or not. But with the wind trickling in here, it's quite a warm wind. You would like to think that there's at least one or two fish in this bay that we're fishing at the moment. So the plan of attack for today, I suppose, is just to stick with it. I think if you start changing spots and moving rods around, putting different beds of bait here, there and everywhere, it just ruins your fishing for you. So all I'm going to do is stick with it, like I say, but in a couple of hours time I'm going to go around with a leading rod and perhaps try and find some fish. It's where it's been, you know, winter time, they sort of huddle up together and get in big groups, and often what you can find is you can chuck a lead about and sort of bump the lead off of their backs, keep the rod up fairly high as you bring the rod back. Sometimes you can feel a group of fish, or you bump the lead into a group of fish. So I might do that a bit later on, and even if that don't work, chucking the lead up the other end of the pond might scare them down this way, who knows. But I've got to do something. I can't just sit here and hope for something to happen. Perhaps go and try and find a few fish a bit later on. In the meantime, hope that one of these rods rips off.
Well, good morning and welcome. As you can see, dressed up like an absolute Eskimo, thermals on, warm coat, stupid hat, because it went absolutely Baltic in the night, so much so that I still got my summer cover on my bag, and I woke up stupid o'clock dithering, so ran back to the van. I thought I always bring me warmer, like my big thick thermal cover for my bed, chuck that on, snug as a bug. But on the fishing front, it's all slow. I had those two bites yesterday, and I did think, and it's obviously not a dig or anything, but Mozza and Perry hadn't cast in by then, and whilst we're nowhere near each other, I think the angle that I had the bite, certainly on the right rod, on the reeds, they're using that, they use the reed line to patrol, and Mozza and Perry, they're fishing sort of way around the corner. I just think it may have cut my route off. And then the other rod, which I had the middle rod which went, which was the 27 and a half, that was just off, a couple of rod lengths off the tip of the island by the pampas grass. So that could still do another bite. But interestingly, this morning, probably about half an hour ago, I had a savage liner on the left rod, which is just off the tip of the island on the left tip. Really, really hard drop, definitely onto gravel. And it's a bang on bite time, so I'm kind of still a bit like a cat on hot bricks, thinking, I think there's still a bite in this swim. I've got probably another 20 hours to go. I'm going to bolt early tomorrow morning just to miss the traffic on Mammoth Drive home. But I haven't changed any tactics. It went really cold, like I say. You can see the sun's out on a very, very cold night, and the pressure's through the roof. For me, not the time to be, you know, even I'm not getting any liners with the exceptions of that one that's very, very close in off the tip. So I'm just going to carry on doing what I'm doing. To be honest, my trip was made yesterday to get a 27 and got an amazing 36 and a half pounder, which was just scale perfect, lovely, lovely carp for the time of year. I really don't care if I don't catch anything else, but I'm just not going to change anything. Still German rigs, the Milky Malt wafters and the little bags. I think that kind of combination of a bit of attraction and the kind of really bright, it's almost sight feeding. You know, me and Moz have spoke about this a lot before, about when you get day bites in the winter, I definitely think it's a sight thing, which is why I'm not using a matching switch wafter, because I'm literally putting half a handful to a handful of 8mm switch alongside over the rig, just enough. You know, if you were to get them in your hand, it's not a lot of bait at all. It's really not a lot of bait. So rather than use a matching switch, I just want to use something that I think predominantly you get day bites on this lake at this time of year. I want to see something, use something that's bright, that they see. You know, you've still got the attraction, because whilst the pallets have broken down,
that will broken down into the sediment of the clay, gone under bits of gravel, and I think that just pulls them down. They see the white, the milky moor, and they grab it, you know. But I think now there's more lines. It's only a very small lake here at Pullens at Elphicks, so it's, I think they're very, very aware of you fishing for them. And whilst I'm fishing quite slack lines, I'm using fluorocarbon line, you know, I'm not going to get as many liners as Mozza probably has or as Perry has. So I'm fishing a lot more stealthy. I'm doing hardly any casting. You know, maybe I should, you know, it's hard to get the balance of in the winter. You know, a lot of people will say, well, give it an hour in one spot and then move it. You know, it's always worth. But I've had a bite on two of my rods and I've had a really good liner, which is an indication of carp moving this morning on the other rod. So for me, I've mapped the swim out perfectly. I've got them in 100% the right spots. And let's be honest, I'm not going to move the right or the middle because I've already caught and I've bites in those spots. So it's, winter fishing is tough. You know, sometimes it can be a real mental game. Have you got the staying power? You know, can you withstand the 15-hour nights? Can you withstand the cold? You know, are you prepared? Are you going to be warm and comfortable? And but when you get a result like I've had, then it's all worthwhile. So, you know, whilst it's a very, very long way for me to come, everything is good in my world. So I guess going through today, I'm just going to keep watching the water. If I see signs, if I see a fish, absolutely I'll put a rig on it. But if I don't, I'm just going to leave them on the basis that less is more. You know, less disturbance could equal more results on the mat. So everything's fine, everything's good. My session is made. You know, I've had a really, really fantastic couple of fish, which for the time of year, I'm just absolutely blown away from. The standard of fish here at Elphicks, not just in Pullens, but in all the lakes, is just second to none. I just wish it was a damn sight closer to Stoke-on-Trent than it is. So we will crack on, we'll watch that water. Anything happens, you'll be the first to know.
About that for a perfect way to start this brisk winter's morning with this epic one. Oh, I'm absolutely buzzing. 27 pound he went and caught on one of the switch half tones, the white ones. Absolutely mega. The power of the switch this trip has just been something to be admired. This is a maggot dominated water and yet the switch has come through once again in the winter for us. Absolutely mega. And whilst I was playing this one, Tong was playing one at the exact same time as well. And he's got a special one opposite. So Oh man, I'm absolutely blown away. I'm so happy that I sat on my hands yesterday. I didn't change my spots, just stuck with it, and it's paid off for me this morning with this cold water beast. Yes!
What a way to finish off the last morning. Couple of hours to go, and my session was already made, to be honest, with those couple of fish that I've already had, but this has spun the dial to 42 pounds 6 ounces of winter Elphicks mirror, and it's absolutely bolted white over this morning. Everything frozen solid, apart from the water, that is. And then this one has just topped off a memorable shoot on the winter series, and it's bittersweet. It was the only rod that I hadn't had a bite on. It was a left-hand spot, and strangely, or maybe coincidentally, that I didn't recast it yesterday. I'd put it out the day before, and rather than put it out with a little bag of crayfish mini mix, I was just concerned that maybe the silverfish were picking away at them, so I put a little bag of 8mm switch, just so that there was some substantial food there until I reeled in, or until such time as I got a bite, and then this is the one. But I heard a good fish bosh just off the reeds, probably an hour after dark, and then I thought, oh, well, we'll get a bite, and then it took probably 12 hours more for it to go. But what a scrap. Fought like mad, but what a carp. What a carp. Absolutely buzzing my rocks off with a 40 pounder in the winter. Mega.
Right, so that's it, another end to an epic winter series session. And unfortunately for me or Perry, there was no more bites to be had, but what a session that was for Tom. I mean, to have a 20, a 30 and a 40 any time of the year is unbelievable, but it's that little bit sweeter when you get out there in the freezing cold and end up catching some monsters like he did. So yeah, I'm more than happy to have that one fish this morning. A bit of a shame for Perry not to have, you know, managed to catch one, but he catches too many from here as it is anyway. So yes, all that's left to say is thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.